morning.
Morning.
So thank you on behalf of the Stockholm Environment Institute and our partner organizations for coming here today to the first international conference on fossil fuel supply and climate policy. And we're really happy that in the end so many of you could make it here. And as Mike already said, we might fill up the room completely, so keep some spaces open for colleagues. So over the last years, we've witnessed a number of very significant developments in the fight against climate change. I would assume that all of you know, of course, that last year the Paris Agreement was adopted, and world leaders committed to transforming the global economy, but also to moving away from fossil fuels and onto the pathway towards a low-carbon economy. And also with last week's UN meeting in New York, it's becoming increasingly likely that we will have an early entry into force of this agreement, which is quite a momentous achievement. At the same time, as was also underlined last week during the 1.5 degrees conference right here in Oxford, much of the hard work and the hard choices still lie ahead. So climate change mitigation efforts need to be scaled up. They need to be scaled up quickly. They need to be scaled up dramatically. We know this. But we also need to think about combining proven approaches with new ideas for accelerating this move towards a low carbon economy. So it's therefore clear that we need all the available levers that we have at our hands to tackle this problem. But while we know that action across the board is necessary, climate policy, as we know it, has focused thus far primarily on measures to reduce the use of fossil fuels. And we're talking about carbon pricing and measures to promote the uptake of renewable energy, for example. So with this conference, we're trying to basically work towards a shift in this approach. And we want to explore different types of policies and actions and to look at their potential. And these actions we're calling is supply-side policies or supply-side climate policies. So in this conference, we want to discuss how these types of policies can supplement and enhance other more demand-side-oriented policies. And through your research and outreach, and many of you in this room have been involved in that, we really think that you've inspired this focus in us, but also in others in this room. And you really brought attention to the fact that only a fraction of the world's fossil fuel reserves can be burned if we are to keep global warming below 1.5 or 2 degrees Celsius. So in the end, we want to explore these questions and look at what they mean for fossil fuel producers, for investors, for policymakers, and so on.
Thanks, Haro. By the way, Haro Ben Asselt, Michael Lazarus. You've gotten lots of emails from us, I think. So it's fantastic to be here. It's really exciting. And as Haro was saying, the reason we wanted to bring you all here together is because many of you in this room are really leaders in beginning to think about and propose these ideas for what we're calling supply-side policies. What they might look like, what are their prospects, what are their implications. So what do we mean? We mean items that have been on the agenda for some time, such as removing subsidies for fossil fuel exploration and production. Then newer ideas like we'll hear about in this morning's panel is a bit of a teaser about various policies, like a moratorium on new coal mines. Or what about a tax or a fee on fossil fuel production, coal in particular? What about funds to leave fossil fuels in the ground for developing countries, particularly in biodiversity hotspots? Countries deciding not to approve infrastructure projects, whether it's pipelines, or as we saw in the US with the Keystone XL pipeline, with the rationale being around the signal related to climate change, or around lands that are under control of the federal government for production of various fuels. We'll hear about that. We'll hear also a bit about fossil fuel producers and new strategies that they may be adopting or considering in light of the changing circumstances. So the question really before us is, under what conditions can policies like this really be feasible? Can they be effective? Can they be efficient? Can they be equitable? Can they be fair? What do they mean in terms of a transition, a just transition, especially for communities, workers, governments, dependent upon the revenue from fossil fuel production? How can we make this work? So that's why we brought you here today, to have a lively debate about whether we can address climate change from the supply side, and whether we can bring policies together that help really more effectively put us on that 1.5 or 2 degree trajectory. So our hope in this conference is that you will all be having discussions in these rooms, outside, create new collaborations, come up with new research ideas, so we can really push the ball forward together. So thank you so much for coming all the way to Oxford to join us today. So, but before we jump into the content, we have the practical matters that we have to run through. First of all, the most mundane one being, just so you know, the restrooms are a bit hidden. If you head out these doors, down the stairs. Second thing to be aware of is that we are being webcast live. It's on the SEI YouTube channel, I think, right, Marian? If you are presenting, and if you have a concern about that, let us know, and we can make arrangements accordingly. We have a tight schedule. We had a lot of people we wanted to put on stage and talk to you, as well as those who are in the audience who normally are on the stage, and gosh, we wish we could have fit you all in. So we want to stick to a tight schedule so you can make the most of the sessions as well as the most of the breaks. So speakers, moderators, be aware that we are going to be tough. I know we say that, but we mean it. If you have logistical questions, we have two fantastic go-to people from our SEI Oxford office. Stefan Bosner, please stand up. Julia Barrett. So if you have questions, whether it's around the internet, the facilities, around the what's coming up next, please feel free to get in touch with them. And aren't we supposed to do a little safety talk?
Yeah.
Okay. We signed a little contract. If there's a fire, go to the lawn outside. If they're falling objects, duck. All right. So with that. Oh, yes.
Uneven surfaces.
Uneven surfaces,
old,
yes.
Old college.
So crawl everywhere. All right. So it's really, with that, we want to turn to opening this conference. And we can think of no one better to open this conference than Paul Ekins. Many of you have cited the work of Paul Ekins and Christoph McGlade, the work that they did 3 years ago that Paul will refresh us on a little bit shortly. Paul is a professor of resources and environmental policy and director of the Institute for Sustainable Resources at University College in London, and deputy director of the UK Energy Research Centre, has been involved in leading energy policy in the UK for some time. So it's with great honor we welcome Paul Ekins to say a few words at the beginning of this conference. Thank you.
Well, thanks, Michael and Harrow. And obviously, it's a huge privilege and pleasure to be here just to kick this important conference off with really two sets of thoughts. The first arising from this paper, McGlade and Ekins, not Ekins and McGlade, very important academically. And I'm very glad that Christoph's in the audience, so that if you bowl me any really difficult questions about that paper, I shall have no hesitation in calling him to my aid. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about the implications of that, the policy implications and the investment implications, as with the title, which I think will help us along. So, that was not the right thing. I can get back, but which of these buttons? I'm obviously unlikely to do it again.
You want to move forward?
Okay, that's fine. Okay, so this is the front piece of the letter in Nature that Christoph and I were co-authors on, published last January 2015. It did make quite a splash. In fact, Carbon Brief said that it was the paper on climate change in 2015 that got more media coverage than any other. And as I became an academic to do that kind of thing, I was enormously grateful to Christoph for enabling that to happen, because he of course did most of the work. And those of you who are academics will realize that. So we knew that burning all available fossil fuel reserves would bust the carbon budget for 2 degrees several times over. But we didn't know before Christoph's work how that was split between oil, gas and coal, and of course very different carbon intensities, and probably most important, where those unburnable resources would be likely to be. And I say would be likely to be, and we've engaged in considerable correspondence about this. You'll see there's a normative statement in the title there, should stay underground. Well, that's really difficult. On what basis should stay underground? Clearly, a lot of it has to if we want the 2 degrees, let alone the 1.5 degrees. But how do we choose? Well, I'm an economist, and so we choose, or our model chose, on the basis of least cost. So we burnt the cheapest fossil fuels first, up to the carbon budget. I'm not going to spend much time on this. Many of you will do modeling yourselves. I think models are not God, but models are useful. If they have these three qualities especially, and if they don't have those three qualities, then the model is less useful. But when the structure is robust, and this is the Times modeling system developed out of the Markov modeling system developed by the International Energy Agency, so lots of people around the world have worked on this modeling system, and so we're standing on the shoulders of giants very much. Where the input assumptions are plausible, and we'll talk a lot about the input assumptions before you get the results, and where the data quality is high. It was as high as Christoph could make it. I had no idea there was so much uncertainty about fossil fuel reserves. I kind of thought, well, we sort of knew what was out there, but this is by no means the case. So this is a little graphic of TAM-UCL. Those of you who know energy system models will understand it very easily. It starts here with energy service demands that are generated by some projections of GDP or whatever, right across heat, power, transport, so it's the whole energy system. And then on the basis of least cost optimization, it works back through the energy system, through transmission, conversion, to primary resources. And our version also has a climate module, which we've invested quite a lot in order to try to make it consistent with some of the global circulation models, so that we can either constrain temperature, which is what we did in our model run, or we can constrain carbon emissions, and obviously by constraining temperature, you do constrain atmospheric concentrations and therefore emissions. So the model calculates the impact of selected primary energy sources on emissions and temperature rise, but as I say, you can work backwards. Lots of input assumptions have to be made. So regional, global population, GDP growth rates, costs, rates of low-carbon technology development, etc. We, and I mean Christoph, did an enormous number of sensitivities around those input assumptions. First paper I'd ever been associated with that was published in Nature. It took us 9 months to respond to referees' concerns, so that's a lot. You'll see extent to which the referees forced us to go in order to get it published. And this is the core of the work, if you like. It's supply cost curves for the three major fossil fuels, oil. And before we did this work, I had no idea that there were so many different kinds of oil. I kind of thought, well, oil is oil, innit? But no, oil is not oil, innit? There's all these different sorts. And this is gas, and different kinds of gas. And this is coal, rather fewer kinds of coal, and the cost curves at which they can be extracted. And I've already said it's a least cost optimizing model, so you would have expected the model to work up the marginal cost curve of each of those resources with different carbon intensities, of course. And the constraint was this little green bar here, which is the IPCC's carbon budget for 2050 for 2 degrees, with the light green being the uncertainty range, and you can see it's around 1,000 gigatons, a trillion tons of carbon dioxide. So we constrained the model only to emit a trillion tons, to meet the energy service demands that came out of our analysis of various GDP projections and therefore energy consumption. And you can see from this the extent to which the available reserves and resources exceed this little green bar. The dark brown is reserves, and that's about three times as much carbon as we can afford to burn according to this budget. The dark brown are resources, where reserves are broadly defined as resources that can be produced with current technologies in a defined period of time in an economically viable way. Obviously, lots of uncertainty about that. Depends on whether the oil price is $40 a barrel or $140 a barrel. But to some extent, you make those assumptions there. And that was the extent of the problem. The left panel, and this is just a few of the sensitivity analyses which the referees required us to do, is the range of projected global GDP from all the scenarios used in the IPCC fifth assessment report. I can't remember exactly how many there are now, but I think it's in excess of 1,000. So that's a lot of runs that we had to do to have a look at that, and a huge variation by 2050 in how rich the world is going to be. So that's GDP in trillions of dollars, and there is the range. And obviously, the energy service demands that come out of that are very varied. And then there was another whole range of sensitivities there. 2DS is our central 2-degree scenario. 5DS is essentially no climate policy, so not even INDCs, so we hope we're already beyond that. 3DS is constraining the model to 3 degrees. And then these are the bars for oil, gas, and coal that come out of the model. With low and high fossil fuel prices, with whether we allow it to have bio-CCS or not, so all these various sensitivities. And this is the kind of key result which got people quite excited. I've highlighted the big numbers of the unburnable reserves. So remember, there's a whole heap of resources out there on top of these reserves. And you can see that Canada keeps 74% of its oil unburned. That, of course, is the oil sands in Canada. The Middle East, 38%, seems to be quite a small percentage, but when if you look at the quantity of oil that is in burnt under that scenario, you can see that that's a lot of gigabarrels. Gas here, again, a lot in the Middle East, former Soviet Union has a lot. And coal, the headline figure down here, 82% remains unburnt, with some world burning less than 10%, so more than 90% remaining unburnt. So some pretty challenging stuff. The model generates an implicit carbon price, so that's the kind of policy. So in a way, an economist would say this is the result of an optimal policy. And we know the world doesn't really operate like that, but there you are. I mean, that's the way it is. And you can see that the carbon price takes a run up to 2020 because of various short-term constraints we put on the model, and then has a nice little curve going up to about $250 per ton of CO2 by 2050. Now, you'll be thinking, well, that's obviously completely unreal. Interesting thing is that Sweden, of course, already has a carbon price of 100 euros per ton of carbon dioxide. So Sweden is already up here, well before 2020. The UK tax on petrol and diesel, or gasoline, as I think you call it in the United States, is something like 350. If you computed that as a carbon price, is about $350 a ton. Of course, it isn't a carbon price. It's a revenue-raising measure, and it's been in place since the 1970s. But it shows that it is at least possible to tax fossil fuels now at the kind of level that we're envisaging in order to drive the 2-degree target. Really interesting to see the trajectory over time of these different fossil fuels. Some people have commented the fact that we use quite a lot of oil right the way through to 2040 before it starts really to decrease. So there's this carbon budget isn't zero. A trillion tons is quite a lot of carbon, and there's a lot of oil used. There's the coal you can see dropping off a cliff there, and substituting for the coal is the gas, and again, something that has been subject to some comment is the fact that in the short to medium term, more gas is used in the 2-degree scenario than is used in the 5-degree scenario, but then, of course, the gas plateaus off as well. And as we know, in the second half of the century, all fossil fuels will have to fall so that net emissions go to zero. But we didn't report out to that. A couple of little results that have also caused some comment. CCS doesn't make a great deal of difference, and lots of people have said, well, how is that possible? Why is CCS not the savior of coal? And you can see it only increases by 6% the quantity of coal that can be burned. And the reason for that really is the constraints that we put on the model before 2050. We don't allow the model to build CCS until 2025, commercial CCS, that is, and even that's beginning to look a little optimistic now, given the huge scale of the plants that would be required to make a difference. And then we constrain the build rate out to 2050, because it's clear that once the model, the problem with optimizing models is that if it likes a technology, it likes to do nothing else if that's cost effective. And so one needs to constrain it in those ways. This is a picture of the conditions that would be necessary in order to continue to produce or to produce new oil sands from Canada. You will know that producing oil sands in Canada is a very energy intensive process. At the moment, the input fuel for that production is mainly natural gas. Natural gas is obviously carbon intensive, or relatively not carbon free, let's put it that way. And if you were to completely decarbonize all the energy inputs into producing Canadian oil sands, then the model suggests that they would be cost optimal and they could be produced. But that is a huge ask. A lot of bioenergy would need to go in order to substitute for the natural gas that is currently used for gas production. Oh, and I'll come back to this little statement down here that there's no development of oil or gas resources in the Arctic. So that's kind of the quick presentation. So what does all this mean? Well, it has huge implications, obviously, both for politics and for businesses. So we did this work, obviously, before Paris, but Paris, long on rhetoric, long on ambition, and clearly this has huge geopolitical implications about how fossil fuels are going to be produced, huge implications for licensing or fossil fuel exploration. Lots of countries busy licensing new exploration, I hope, finding reserves. And if the implication of that, if we're serious about the budget, of course, is that if we produce resources that are not produced in the model, then to stay within the carbon budget, some resources that were produced in the model will have to stay underground. And how, what kind of decision-making process can we envisage that will allow some countries to produce fossil fuels and others not to produce them if they are there and if they're available? Should developing countries have special dispensation? I think Michael said we're going to have a session on that. We're doing some modeling on that for DFID. With IAED. Steve Pye is leading that. Yep, but he's certainly talking later. There he is. Yep. And obviously enormous justification for exploration, production, financing. Really, we're following up the work, I guess, that Carbon Tracker has been doing on that. I've been very busy with the investment community. And of course, that's now right at central bank level with the Financial Stability Board. Various central bank governors investigating what exactly corporations should be telling us, especially fossil fuel corporations, about their Moving on then very quickly to investment. Well, the sums of money that need to shift direction are very large indeed. I mean, mind-bogglingly large. it's extraordinary that with those numbers, as well as with others, there's a lot of uncertainty. So it depends whether you believe the IEA. Their estimates of $1 trillion a year of extra investment that is required in low carbon energy, or whether you believe the new climate economy, which is a mere $270 billion extra in low carbon. And again, this will depend on assumptions about the costs of low carbon energy sources. And as we know, over the last 10 years, anyone who was forecasting the costs of low carbon energy sources would have been proved very badly wrong, because the prices, the costs of solar and of wind have fallen much more quickly than anyone was anticipating. Overall, the IEA thinks that something like $100 trillion is going to be need to be invested over this 40-year period. So that's quite a lot. It's $2.5 trillion a year. Much of this is currently destined, or was when we were doing this work, for fossil fuel infrastructure, but it's really encouraging that a lot of that investment is now being rethought. So 10 years ago, we were all talking about China having projections for one new coal-fired power station every week or whatever it was. And if you look at the projections for coal-fired power stations in China now, they're considerably reduced. They're not zero, but they are considerably reduced. And that needs to go to low carbon infrastructure. So how are we going to generate $3 trillion a year in low carbon investments? Well, some of it is already happening, but $330 billion is not nothing, but it's clearly not $3 trillion. Private investment is going to be doing most of the heavy lifting, and that means that it's going to have to, these investments are going to have to command a risk-reflective normal rate of return. Low oil and gas prices are fascinating because they're kind of a double-edged sword. They help choke off investment in new fossil fuel developments, and we've seen enormous reductions in exploration and production investments over the last year or so since the fossil fuel prices fell. But also they obviously deter or delay investment in clean energy, because the gap between renewables, low carbon, and fossil fuels widens as the oil. So while those low carbon investments are more expensive, we're going to need public policy. And broadly, unless these low carbon energy sources do become cheaper than fossil fuels, it's hard to see how So I'm not going to spend any time on this. Imagine that the conference will explore these ideas in a lot of detail. Policy needs to be consistent, predictable, and transparent. Pretty well everything that UK energy policy has not been since. We need to get out of fossil fuel subsidies. Many of you will know the IMF paper that suggests that they're around $5 trillion a year if you include externality costs, which of course, as good economists, you should, but which we normally do not include. Carbon pricing, I have a preference for carbon taxes, but I'll settle for emissions trading where it works. Large-scale R&D in energy storage, energy-related ICT, and of course in fuel production technologies generally. Policy support of all kinds in order to close that gap between the price of low-carbon energy sources and fossil fuels. Huge push for sustainable urbanization. If we build cities the way they've been built West, and especially in the United States, it would be quite impossible to get anywhere near to. Need to do something about deforestation, forest degradation, and food and diet, and going on at the college dining room. So here we are, this is my last slide, and the risk of stranded assets is positively related to the stringency of carbon emissions mitigation policy. And it's very, I find it really interesting as a policy person. You can actually tell how likely the fossil fuel companies think stringent climate policy is by their whole attitude to their existing assets. And it is different between them. So you've got ExxonMobil on one hand, which basically it doesn't think climate policy is ever going to do much, and of course it does what it can to ensure that that's the case. And then you've got some of the other fossil fuel companies who are
starting again to invest a bit in low carbon. Some fossil fuel assets are already stranded, and it will be fascinating to see what the various central bank and other task forces come up with once the report comes, and which assets are stranded. In my view, and it was fascinating what Michael said right at the beginning about, you know, focusing on the supply side, I think that which assets are stranded is going to be decided by consuming countries and not by producing countries. I cannot imagine a global agreement whereby Saudi Arabia or Russia or any of the other guys with those assets can say, okay, guys, we won't produce these. I was up in Tromsø a week or so ago, and I think one or two people that may have come from that workshop, and there was a very, very insistent and impressive gentleman from the Norwegian Oil and Gas Corporation, arguing like crazy that they need to go off and produce Arctic resources. And I see my model that we don't produce Arctic resources. And he was saying these Arctic resources are really cheap, they can go in there, they can do them. And so I asked him, I said, well, if you produce the Arctic resources, who is not going to produce the resources? Because if any country in the world needn't produce fossil fuels, it's Norway. It's very, very rich. It has a huge sovereign wealth fund because it has acted in a very responsible manner in its fossil fuels today. But it actually doesn't need to produce fossil fuel resources. And yet the Norwegian Oil and Gas Corporation is absolutely determined to go and do that. So there's a huge debate in Norway. And I was a sort of caught between the crossfire of Norwegian NGOs that didn't want to produce fossil resources in the Arctic and the industry that did. So I think it's going to come from consumers. Energy markets will only push low carbon to the extent that they're cheaper than fossil fuels. And the role of public policy is to make that happen in as cost-effective a way as possible. Policymakers will only do that if low carbon energy sources are perceived to have other advantages. I think as we know, the actual momentum politically towards climate policy is relatively weak nationally and on the ground. And what's driving China's concern in these issues, of course, is largely air quality locally. That's fine. That's where the big externalities are, according to the IEA analysis. And so climate policy, carbon reduction, becomes a kind of co-benefit rather than the other way around. So it is happening, and Paris was hugely encouraging, but of course, as we know, it's not happening anything like enough to get us to 2 degrees, let alone 1.5, and I hope that this conference will give us a little bit more momentum on that route. Thank you very much.
Don't go anywhere. Especially after that last slide. Thank you so much for sort of a great overview of the sort of table you set with your study, as well as these conclusions that you draw, which suggest that, you know, supply side policy, as we've talked about and some people have worked on, is a challenge. I think people are aware of that. So with that in mind, we'll have a chance to talk about some of those shortly, but we wanted to allow the audience to throw in a few questions here because we're about to cut to another panel. So surely there must be questions. Let's take 3 questions. And I saw a hand in the back and the 2 right there, and we'll get to these other 2 should we have time. I think, yes, I think it's Cooney, yes.
Thanks. Cooney Chan with the Nature Conservancy in New York. So we have an interest in supply-side approaches to restricting coal in the United States. I had an interest in some of the cost curve charts that you showed earlier in your presentation. So does your research suggest that restricting fossil fuels, should you tackle the high end of the cost curve or the low end of the cost curve? Is there a bias one way or the other?
Mark, hold on. Nick's running. There were two hands that just came up before you.
Hands up. So we were debating which.
Okay. So I believe it's you. Yes, Miles, right?
Okay. So the main policy discriminant between whether we
scenarios where we meet 2 degrees affordably and those in which we cannot afford to meet 2 degrees is the rate of penetration of CCS over the century as a whole. So by limiting it, you could argue that your paper fed the perception that CCS can't help, where it's abundantly clear that it's the only thing that can help. So does this keep you awake at night?
My question is simply, because this research was done before Paris and there was such a strong sentiment to embrace a 1.5 degree target in Paris, are you thinking of recalculating these balances between the different sources of carbon?
Before we jump on, Mark, hold off for a second. We'll do this round and then we'll get to you. Introduce yourselves, please.
Sorry, I'm Miles. I'm the University of Oxford.
I'm Bob Massey at the University of Massachusetts.
Okay, thanks. Well, if you're going to focus on the supply side, the market will obviously be more keen to produce the low-cost resources than the high-cost resources. And I think that when the market is giving certain signals, then it is possible for policymakers to reinforce those. So that coal in the US, my understanding is it's largely been undercut by shale gas, and that that's what is driving the reduction in coal use. I think under those circumstances, public policy can firstly ease the transition, which is really important if climate policy isn't going to hurt lots of people. And yes, it obviously then does make sense to ensure that you're not subsidizing the high-cost stuff to bring it on stream first. As far as I'm aware, there's not a lot of that going on in the US, but I'm not terribly up with subsidy policy in the US. What I do know is that in Europe, we do still subsidize high-cost coal to quite a large extent. The Germans in particular, despite their vaunted energy measure, and that's obviously a big problem. Rate of penetration, CCS, nice, challenging question, Miles. No, I don't. It doesn't actually keep me awake at night, because when I'm asked, I always say CCS may be important later in the century. I'm very critical of the government having pulled the plug on our own CCS policy here. And it would have been great if 10 years ago when we started talking about this, we had commercial CCS up and running. But I still think that the assumptions we make in the model, which is that you don't get your first commercial deployments till 2025, and that there is then a constraint on the feasible rate of building, I think those are perfectly reasonable assumptions. And they do make the whole business much more challenging. And I wish we would get on with dealing with that technology, especially for industry. But the CCS people that I talk to say you can't do just industry because it doesn't justify the infrastructure investment. So you'd have to do industry and power together and co-locate them where that made sense. So I think CCS is fine, but I think we need to be aware that the longer we wait before we actually do it at scale, the windows are closing. And of course, after 2050, there is a carbon budget, but it's a much smaller carbon budget, certainly for 1.5 degrees. And CCS is not a zero carbon technology. So it uses up to 25% more energy, and it only captures 90% max of carbon emissions. So that is a significant part of the carbon budget post 2050. And on 1.5 degrees, yeah, no, you can imagine that having got this beast of a model, we're dead keen to use it under all possible circumstances, where it's appropriate, of course. 1.5 degrees is a push, though. The model doesn't like 1.5 degrees. It will produce lots and lots of bio-CCS if you allow it to do that, to get the negative emissions that the model accounts. Well, we know that bioenergy may not be negative emissions. In fact, there are some studies that suggest bioenergy is more carbon intensive than some fossil fuels. So production of zero net emission bioenergy is one thing, and then obviously we've talked about the CCS. So if one stresses models to that extent, then it really shows how difficult 1.5 degrees C is. Nevertheless, we shall do it, and then we'll try to weave a narrative around that that seems to make it feasible.
All right, we have time for one more round of questions.
Yes.
Let's see hands. Hands, yes, Mark, Laura. Okay, and then one last question.
So, I'm Mark Fulton from ETA and Carbon Tracker. So, your model, like all models, shows how dominant coal is in the numbers. And I'm pushing the paper I'm about to give, but within that, we know that the Asian coal markets dominate that, and within that, China dominates. And I would make one comment, the notion that China has suddenly stepped back is ridiculous. There's 205 gigawatts of construction as we speak. That's definitely one a week. Do you feel that maybe that because China is SOE, because it's public coal and so on, that to some extent in this whole discussion, we spend a lot of time on oil and gas, right? We talk about coal, but the heart of the coal problem is in the public sector. And somehow we're all sort of hoping for the best or something. I don't know what that is. Maybe it's CCS in China. That's a real option. But I just wonder whether you feel that the coal story is getting underplayed as it is the carbon bomb.
Hi, my name is Laura Merrill. I'm with the Global Subsidies Initiative of IISD. It's not a question about subsidies. It's asking Paul for... This was really groundbreaking in that it was about modeling for keeping it in the ground based on this temperature that we've got to stay within. Could we do modeling for what we need to do for sustainable energy, for renewables, for energy efficiency, and how will that have to take off? What modeling can we do to see how quickly that's going to have to move to take the space of this energy we're using, and what kind of feed-in tariffs are we going to need? Which natural resources, which sustainable natural resources are we not utilising that we should be or could be? So are there any good papers that sort of look at the inverse of this question, to take it from the sky and to take it from other resources, natural sustainable resources, and the inverse of keep it in the ground?
Hi, Seb Hembest from Bloomberg New Energy Finance. The question's about sort of the zero-sum game nature of this and how you divide up the different energy resources. So just get a clue of how in the modelling you divided between sort of transport and electricity generation, and whether there was any, and whether the substitution options for those two parts of the energy matrix were, how they were captured. So in other words, are we baking in the assumption that oil gets a free run because we haven't got the substitutes for X number of years, and therefore coal has to cop it? Or how do we make the balance between oil, coal and gas, considering the rapid reduction in costs of different technologies that we're now observing?
Thank you. My name is Nimo Basi from Health of Mothers Foundation in Nigeria. I would like to know, I mean, the Paris Agreement set the targets of 1.5 degrees Celsius or well below 2 degrees. Could you help me figure out what well below 2 degrees means? Is it above 1.5 or below 1.5?
Right. Okay. Well, that's great. Cole, you're undoubtedly better informed than I am, Mark, about Chinese coal plants. My understanding was that they're still building quite a lot of plants, but that they've definitely scaled back on the number that they're planning to build in the future. Only marginally. Okay, so that cause of excess optimism has just been quashed. So I'm sorry about that. I try to keep optimistic, but I'm aware that, this is tough. If I can go to Bloomberg next. Obviously, the carbon thing is a zero-sum game.
What is not a zero-sum game? And I'm fully of the opinion that it was this change in discourse that led to Paris being more positive outcome-wise than Copenhagen. What is not a zero-sum game is the economic opportunities of low carbon. And that seems to me to have been transformed in the years between Copenhagen and Paris. So that it is possible now, if you're an optimist, and obviously one has not against being a Pollyanna, to say, yeah, these new technologies can actually drive a new industrial revolution. You will know the language, you'll have read the new climate economy reports. But if we don't have that kind of narrative, then nothing will happen. And so I think it's really important to get a kind of positive aspirational narrative, which is now at least credible, given the technological advances that we've got. And I think for me, the most important thing coming out of Paris was not the 2 or 1.5 degrees, but it was the very significant messages about investment in innovation that came from both the public sector with mission innovation, all that stuff, doubling R&D budgets, but also from the private sector, because when people like Branson and Gates say they're going to invest a lot of money, they're doing it as business people. So they think there is a business story there rather than just a public policy story. And so that's really hopeful. On the other resources, well, of course, the model produces the other resources. The model says these energy service demands have to be satisfied. And if they're not going to be satisfied by fossil fuels, they're satisfied by someone else, by something else. So we could tell you from the model how much renewables there was, how much PV, how much wind, how much energy efficiency. Those, of course, are a result of cost assumptions like everything else, and allowing the model to choose that. I didn't touch on the Bloomberg thing about split between transport and electricity. The real strength of the Times model is that it has got all energy uses there, and therefore it chooses among the cost optimal options. The reason that the oil goes on for longer is because it's more difficult to decarbonize transport than it is to decarbonize the power sector. So you decarbonize the power sector first, and then quite a lot of transport goes over to the power sector. So we get battery electric vehicles, we get hydrogen, a lot of the hydrogen produced from natural gas with CCS. And so that comes back again, the importance of CCS, if you allow the model to do that. So it really is important to have a kind of whole system model that that goes below that, and that takes all those things into account. On the basis of the technologies we know about, obviously there will be technologies, hopefully, that come up over the next 20, 30 years that we don't know anything about. Imo, on what does well below 2 degrees mean? Well, your guess is as good as mine. I'm certainly not going to second guess the Paris negotiators. You will know the politics around this. You will know that there was the High Ambition Group, largely driven by the small island states, putting a very strong moral argument for why they shouldn't be inundated. And obviously, they may well be inundated even at 1.5 degrees. So I don't think anyone believes that we can keep below 1.5 degrees. Barring some catastrophe to civilization or whatever. Where between 1.5 and 2 are we going to end up if we take the necessary steps? I have no idea. I will be very pleased if we stick to 2, if I'm...
Thank you so much, Paul. We're now going to transition to our panel. We're going to have, that was great to sort of set the greater challenge that we face in the broader context here of what is possible through can supply side policy still get us beyond what the standard palette of efforts and the signal and the ambition and the breakthroughs can get us on. So to that, I'd like to invite up Frank Jotzo. From the Australian National University. And The way we're going to work this panel, by the way, is we'll be up here. I'll talk a few slides. We'll have a little, a few back and forth questions, Frank and I, and then he'll go sit down. We'll bring up the next person. Then we'll have about 20 minutes or 30 minutes for conversation at the end with between the panel and the audience. So, Frank, the title of your abstract is The Case for Supply-Side Policy. How timely. And you're going to talk to us a little bit about a coal tax as well. So tell us a little bit about what is that case.
Yeah, that's right. So Paul already said it. Coal falls off a cliff under 450 or 2 degrees scenario. Just how far off the cliff very much depends on national approaches, and our friends from the Deep Decarbonization Pathways Project will explain more about that in the following session. But, you know, take any of these scenarios with or without CCS, then from the point of view of a major coal-producing and exporting country such as the one I live in Australia, this can look pretty scary. So Australia, for example, accounts for 7% of global coal production by volume and about 27% of global coal exports. In most recent years, the value of coal exports from Australia account for something like or equate to something like $2,000 per person in the population. Now, of course, those $2,000 don't, the average person actually doesn't see their $2,000, it accrues elsewhere, but it does account for enormous lobbying power within the coal industry and hence impact on public policy. And so, can't resist showing you this. This is the Australian coal industry telling the Australian people that there won't be any more coal beer if you get rid of coal. Okay? So that's kind of where we are. Now, the starting point for the actual analysis that we do, other than showing coal ads, is the contention that in that global decline, right, of coal, it is actually a good idea for coal producing and exporting countries to tax the very resource that is declining. Okay, and the reason for that is essentially rent shifting. Okay, so you try and shift the rents from countries that import and use coal and that get scarcity rent out of a carbon tax to producing countries, and you try and shift the rent from producers, mining companies, to governments who then in turn can try and ease that transition. So this is, of course, not the first transition, industrial or resource transition, that takes place. So you might have heard of wood to coal transitions. In Australia, we've had a wool to coal transition. It's very likely that coal eventually is going to go the way of the sheep, having constituted a major share of exports and not doing so anymore in the future. Now, that is, of course, a difficult transition, and governments will be tempted to make it easy for industry, and that could mean subsidizing continued coal production and exports. Where we want to roll to in terms of the analysis that we do and put into the public debate is that idea that you want to go the other way and produce revenue and financial resources for governments so that they can actually ease that transition and go with the flow rather than go against it.
So let me get this right, Frank. You're proposing a beer tax.
Yes, that's right, a beer tax, and it's highly popular so far.
Okay, all right, so good. Explain to us how that's going to work. I mean, who is going to pay this tax? How are you going to extract such a tax out of producers, and who would the beneficiaries be?
Yeah, so the basic idea would, of course, be a harmonized tax on coal production or coal exports. Now, this will only work if a significant number of large coal producing and exporting countries come on board. If they don't, then, analysis, modeling-based analysis as well, shows you that very readily the benefits dissipate. However, if you have a significant number of coal producers on board, and there will be a paper presented by Roman Mendelevich tomorrow, I think, showing that can, in fact, impact global coal prices, traded coal prices, and hence coal use prices, and depress coal consumption as well, and thereby help achieve the goal of global climate change mitigation, and that in that process it also shifts some of the rents from consumers to producers. So what coal companies see is a lower coal price in the market. What coal users see is a higher cost of using coal, and the wedge in between that is the tax that accrues to the coal producing governments, okay, to subsidize beer and do other things, good things with it, such as reduce taxes, perhaps even achieve a double dividend, and perhaps try and leave a majority of their population better off. And this is what we're going to analyze as part of our contribution to a new project. It's called the Global Coal Transitions Project. And so we're aiming to do a suite of market modeling, economic modeling, and distributional modeling exercises to investigate to what extent it will in fact be possible through redistributive policies of that kind to leave a majority of the population in a coal-producing country better off.
So, you know, what Paul was talking about earlier, you know, cast doubt on whether producers will be willing to not sell what they can possibly sell. So, presumably you would need some sort of coalition of countries to agree on this. You have a sense of how large you would need to be to avoid that leakage effect that would undermine the policy. Could Australia do it alone, and would there be benefit?
So Australia or any other single major coal producer could not do it alone, or the lack of output from Australia would quickly be taken up by the others. The larger the coalition, the greater the effect, and the larger the benefits to those part in the coalition. So coalition is a good word, much better word than a cartel. There is of course one large historical precedent, and that is OPEC. So really, what we're talking about here is OPEC, but on a price-based model. Now, how realistic is it for the major coal producers to come together and in fact agree on a harmonised coal tax is an altogether different issue. I mean, you know, game theoretic literature tells you that it's very difficult to establish large coalitions. On the other hand, of course, the larger the coalition, the greater the benefit to each individual member of that coalition.
So have you spoken to any policymakers or other researchers? How do they react? Do they think that this is something that's feasible?
Look, I mean, in my country, this is stuff that's well over the horizon, okay? To the extent that it doesn't even cause a great stir, okay, because it's considered so way out there, okay?
But you're going to change that, right?
You know, if you think back 5 or 10 years, right, then a domestic transition away from coal use was considered way out there, not going to happen, crazy stuff. And in Australia, we now have a very viable and sensible debate about how the domestic phase down of coal-using industries. So I am very cautiously optimistic that perhaps over the next decade or two, we can get to somewhere where we can at least discuss these things.
All right. Well, thanks. Thanks, Frank. And hopefully... So go ahead and have a seat over the panel. We don't end up keeping sheep in the ground. Next I have the honor to keep it down under with Richard Dennis. Many of you are familiar with Richard Dennis. Richard is chief economist at the Australia Institute. He's been working on this concept of a new coal mine moratorium. And I was fascinated to see, those of you who here gets the Coal Hub Weekly newsletter? Some of us do here. Very surprisingly, it's a coal industry newsletter. And what was the top story? Was Richard's paper on a new coal mine moratorium in Australia. So, interesting, it's gotten the attention of industry.
Yeah, certainly. And, you know, Frank, where's Frank gone? Frank and I discuss these things a lot. The reality is the coal industry in Australia feels entirely unthreatened by anything Frank and I say. This is important because we are planning in Australia. So, you know, Paul put up his, you know, peak coal's got to come down, and Frank too. We're planning in Australia to build coal mines bigger than Manhattan. We are planning to build coal mines bigger than central London. Go to the top of the Eiffel Tower and look to the horizon, you wouldn't see as far as one of the biggest mines we're currently planning to build. So good on you for 2 degrees, 1.5 degrees. No, seriously. And I hate to say, I agree with a lot of Paul's analysis, but I massively reject his conclusion. If you think that behavior in consuming countries is going to affect us, you're mad. No, you really, okay? There is no scenario in which a world that's tackling climate change needs a 40-kilometer long new coal mine. We're building one for the simple reason that we don't think the world is going to try and tackle climate change. And to be clear, at Paris, we were frustrated that we weren't included in the coalition of ambition. I'm not joking. This is how big the lie is. Okay? And we, of course, supported 1.5 degrees. Okay? Of course, we'll agree with anything you say. Okay? That's what's going on. And then we go off and subsidize the construction of mines bigger than any city you live in. That's what's happening. And no one's turned any point. No one left Paris and went, maybe we shouldn't double our coal output. We've got a bigger share of the traded coal market than the Saudis have of the oil market, and we're planning double output. You think we don't know that's going to push price down? That's our marketing strategy. That's what we say in China, well, not so much China these days, Vietnam, Cambodia, Bangladesh. We say it's going to get cheap. The coal, low coal prices are our marketing strategy, and we'll subsidize the fixed costs, and then the marginal costs are low, so the taxpayer picks up the risk. The taxpayer funds the fixed costs. We build the port, we build the railway lines, and then we sell cheap coal. That's what's going on. 1.5 degrees, 2 degrees, have fun with that.
So what about this moratorium?
Well, if you want... Well, no, here's the thing, like, It wasn't whaling companies, countries that demanded a moratorium on whaling. Do you understand how a moratorium works? It wasn't the whalers that said, let's have a moratorium. It was the rest of the world saying, this can't continue. It's not asbestos miners that say, maybe we should stop mining asbestos. The fact that Australia has no intention of reducing our coal output is why you need to demand a moratorium. If you're waiting for us to stop, stop modelling it. There's no evidence that we're going to stop. Okay, and we've got a, you know, our resources, our former resources minister was just appointed yesterday to run the mining industry's peak political lobby group. Now, if you think markets work, if you think people respond to incentives, if you think rational people spend their money well, then why of all the skills to buy did the peak mining council in Australia think the former politician who ran the resources ministry was the smartest buy to run the... Did they buy an engineer? No. Did they buy an accountant? No. They bought the politician who used to oversee the policy that facilitates this. Not imaginary. This is what we're doing. And my point is, why a moratorium? Because we're not going to stop. We're not going to stop. If you don't want to stop us, that's okay. We'll cause climate change for you. We've got a lot more land. We can move up. All right. But if you want to sit in Europe or somewhere else saying, well, here's what we're doing and I hope Australia will come to the party, just look at the scoreboard. We've doubled our coal output in the last 10 years. We hope to double it again.
So, Richard, how is this moratorium going to work?
Well, really simply. Oops. So some of you are familiar, but you know, the former president of Kiribati wrote to all world leaders saying, I hear you're interested in this climate change thing. If you did that, surely you'd call for a ban on no new coal mines. And of course, no one outside the Pacific did, because you wouldn't want to upset a rich country. So basically, the domestic moratoria, we've recently seen the Obama administration introduce a temporary moratoria on federal lands. The Chinese have announced a moratorium building new coal mines. The Indonesians have recently announced a moratorium. Australia's the last big kid that hasn't. Interestingly, these are all domestically initiated, domestic moratoria. The main benefit of a moratorium is it increases the coal price. Okay? Remember when environmentalists thought you needed expensive fossil fuels to discourage use? Remember the good old days? Now we think low fossil fuel prices are evidence that we're winning. Can't be both, kids. Right, low fossil fuel prices are because we've failed to prevent a flood of supply. And China, America and Indonesia benefit from a moratoria. We're already seeing a coal price pick up because supply isn't growing as fast as it was. This is a benefit. It solves the political problem. You're actually, a moratorium creates a cartel with market share allocated according to incumbent status. Moratorium's great for the owners of incumbent coal. It's terrible for the proponents of new coal. It pushes the price up, but don't panic. The price can't lead to new investment in new mines if you've got a moratorium. The mechanism that causes the price to go up prevents the increase in supply. So there's significant... Oh, I keep doing it wrong. There's significant geopolitical benefits of a moratorium compared to a carbon price. But to be clear, I'm an economist. My PhD was in macroeconomic modelling. I like models, I like economics, but I've also spent a lot of my time working as a political strategist. And if you look at other people that have won fights against big businesses with entrenched political power, take the tobacco industry, I've never heard the public health experts argue with each other about whether a tax on tobacco is better than a restriction on its sale. I've never heard the public health experts kind of disagree about optimal tobacco policy. This is important. They don't talk about optimal policy. They talk about a whole suite of policies that might help, and whenever the political opportunity to grab one comes along, they grab it. All right, and if the government you've got today is more a price than regulation kind of government, then hop on that bandwagon. And as time's gone on in Australia and a lot of countries, you've seen regulatory and price controls go up a lot. So, you don't have to choose.
We have time just for one more minute here. And sort of tell us how you see this moratorium taking off, and then what happens when it gets to countries like India that face a huge development challenge, or Mozambique, who have yet to develop coal resources?
Well, if, and it's a big if, because we're kind of 21 COPs in and no one's mentioned coal yet. But if we agreed that a world that's tackling climate change needed less coal mines, not more, if you had that thought, then you'd have to start an entirely different negotiation with a country like India about what's fair and what's not. But we're not even at step one. And, you know, I live in one of the richest countries in the world and we're still building new coal mines and no one's putting any pressure on us to not. So I think for a country like India, there's no doubt that if I was the Indian government, I'd say, why should we? And we should be able to answer that question for them. But, you know, we haven't even started that conversation yet. And if you think it kind of helps the global south to not boss them around, tell Kiribati that you don't mind if India builds new coal mines.
Well, we don't have much time to start and finish that conversation, but we can continue it shortly. Meanwhile, thank you so much, Richard. And next, I have the pleasure to introduce María Murmis. María is an associate researcher and professor at, hopefully I get this right, why don't you say it?
Universidad Andina Simón Bolívar.
Oh, thank you.
Andean University.
In Quito, Ecuador, who along with Carlos Larrea, Carlos, you're in the audience, yes, has written a paper that you'll find on the website, and they've worked for some time on this question of, starting with the SUNY ITT proposal that Carlos helped to create a few years ago. Right now you've written this new paper on a global fund for keeping fossil fuels in the ground and biodiversity hotspots in developing countries, and put forward a new idea on the sort of policy landscape here. Why don't you give us a quick overview of that?
Okay, well, it's important to get the key idea, which is if we're going to keep... the areas that fossil fuel deposits lying under
under areas of high conservation value, starting with biodiversity hotspots, should be among those resources that are kept in the ground. The first question that comes up is, are there enough fossil fuels under high conservation value areas? And there isn't much data about it, but the most recent study or survey was done by the World Wildlife Fund in World Heritage Sites exclusively, and they found that on average in the world, about 31% of World Heritage Sites have extractive threats. They are either concessions or oil production in them. And in some areas like such as Africa, the percentage is pretty high, it's 61%. And we must keep in mind that these are just World Heritage Sites. We've got areas of high conservation value, global conservation value, in wetlands of international importance, man and biosphere reserves, and areas labeled as critical for conservation by the World Wildlife Funds that are entire regions. And in those regions, we did a quick survey of the 18 regions considered critical for conservation, for global conservation, 12 of them have fossil fuel production. So there's reason that there are enough or many areas of high conservation value that are at risk of fossil fuel production. Okay, so this would come under supply side theory. And what do we say? Supply side theory, as it was said before, would target the resources or the reserves of the lowest economic value. The high cost reserves would be the ones left underground. Supply side theory has also thought of internalizing some environmental costs, such as social cost of carbon, which basically takes into account the carbon content of those reserves and how it would affect the global environment. What supply side theory hasn't done is internalized the cost of affecting the surface areas of global value. So what we are proposing, what we aim to propose, is to internalize that cost. But we think, or we actually think we know, that this can't be internalized with traditional economic tools. So there have to be other tools, such as multi-criteria analysis, to do it. So the purpose of what we're doing is trying to internalize the global cost of destroying the areas that lie over the deposits. And our proposal is a global fund. It comes into play with some other proposals that come from supply-side theory, such as coalitions, where a group of countries that are more committed to climate change come together and stop exploiting their higher cost resources. And what we say is that this global fund could work together with such coalitions.
The right side. Just on the right side of the...
Oh, the right side. Okay, so how would the Global Fund work? Well, we think is that it should be an instrument under the United Nations, and that it has two sides. Countries with biodiversity hotspots propose a project to keep fossil fuels in the ground to be financed, but it's not just being paid for keeping the fossil fuels in the ground. The funds must go to a very well-developed low-emissions development strategy. And this low-emissions development strategy and proposal to keep fossil fuels in the ground has to be socially approved. It is very much modeled under the Yasuni Initiative. I'm not sure everybody is aware of the Yasuni Initiative. Ecuador, in 2007, proposed to the world half the resources from oil under Yasuni. Yasuni is a national park that's one of the biggest concentrations. And a few years later, President Correa canceled the initiative. But it has a very interesting institutional framework was built up, and we're thinking of reproducing that. Now, under this proposal, the global fund would finance projects such as Yasuni. Yasuni would be a project such as other projects that apply to the global fund. And just to keep, how am I on time?
Just one more minute.
Okay, so it is important that the fund would finance both keeping fossil fuels in the ground and a low emissions development path, and that these countries' emissions would have social support. But we're not claiming that this will solve the climate problem, that if we keep all the fossil fuels in the ground under biodiversity rich areas, we're going to get to that 2%. So the effectiveness of the fund is very dependent on other global climate policies that are implemented.
So Yasuni, that was going to cost, I think, $7 billion over the course of 10 years, and we're talking about a global fund. How would you possibly raise that level of funding?
Well, what we think is that if we are to limit fossil fuel production, there's going to be a trend. We're actually allocating rights to exploit to some people and saying to other people, you can't exploit your oil. So in that transfer of rent should be taxed because it's unearned rent, just because fossil fuel prices will go up, and that could be captured to finance.
In a sense, you're creating a scarcity rent, much as Frank was talking to, but you need a more global mechanism to collect it. Okay. We see that there are challenges to many supply-side policies. So why would you be, can you say a word about why Yasuni didn't go forward and why you might be more optimistic about a fund like this?
Yes, well, there are several reasons. One is the context. Now we have the climate agreement. It's not going to take us to the 2 degrees, but it does have the value of having global commitment. Everybody signed it. So there's more of a global commitment to climate change that wasn't there for Yasuni. The second thing is the unburnable reserves, the carbon budget. We didn't have a carbon budget. No one knew, or I think the Meinhausen article came out about 1 year after the Yasuni proposal, so that wasn't very strong, and now we have campaigns for keeping fossil fuels in the ground, so there's the world is more committed to keeping fossil fuels in the ground, and we know we can't burn all the reserves. And other aspects are the social approval that the projects would need to have. Like, we're referring to having referendums in the country so that we know that the country is committed to it and this is not subjected to political change. If we change the president, it still has the social adherence of the whole country. So we think those are aspects that would make it more.
Thank you, María. As mentioned earlier, some of these are little teases of some of the ideas we're going to be exploring in more depth in the sessions to come. And so, transitioning once again, I have the pleasure of introducing Jean Sauvage from the OECD. He's a policy analyst there who's been working on subsidies quite a bit. And now you're going to talk about trade. Why trade?
Thank you, Michael. Good morning, everyone. Yes, why trade? So like Michael said, most of my work in the past has concerned fossil fuel subsidies, and not just the consumer subsidies such as the low prices you find in emerging or developing countries, but also the producer subsidies like tax breaks that are for drilling on public and private lands. So I'm very happy to be here and very thankful for inviting me because I believe supply side issues are important. And I do think trade is a central issue here, central question. Plus, I was asked to actually set the stage in this session, so I want to do something a bit broader and different than just subsidies. So that's why trade. Just as a joke to start, I think this summarizes very well the problem we're facing today. I found this on the internet, I can't remember exactly where, I think it was a Bloomberg site or something. To me, this exactly is the problem. And we've had the same issue when it comes to the reform of producer subsidies. No one wants to go first. But now, coming to the issue of trade, why do I think trade is very important? The first thing to note is that world trade in fossil fuels is about $3 trillion a year. Crude oil is still the number one traded commodity in the world, well ahead of cocoa or coffee or maize or whatever else. If you look at that from the perspective of maritime shipping, so international seaborne trade, UNCTAD has some really good figures on that. And what it shows here, this data I found the other day, is that 42% of all maritime trade by volume is fossil fuels. If you compare that to grain, which is kind of essential to human life, that's 4%. Containers, you know, like the cliche image of trade. It's like the container ships with iPhones made in China and the containers or the cars or whatever, that's 15%. So world trade is, in large part, fossil fuel trade, right? And it's not just maritime shipping. Most of you know that in the US, for example, rail is used a lot for shipping fossil fuels, and not just coal. Now it's you got shale oil coming from North Dakota to the south and the Gulf of Mexico. I was talking about the volume. Now let's look at the value. So I've done some little estimates based on usual trade databases, and what I've found is that we're getting close to fossil fuels representing 20% of the total value of trade in the world. That means that countries import a dollar worth of fossil fuels for every $4 of whatever else they want to import. That's really huge. So that's why I think trade ought to be discussed here.
Well, thanks. So in your abstract, you talk about double standards with respect to fossil fuel trade. How is that possible?
So there's several cases we've identified where we've seen discrepancies or blind spots in the way policymakers look at fossil fuel trade or trading other things like renewable energy equipment. Consider, for example, import tariffs. You may know that currently import tariffs on crude oil, natural gas, almost zero everywhere. Trade barriers are few, very few. And that's reasonable. You know, we've been using oil for decades, so why would you want to impose a tax when you import oil? It's essential for your economy, right? But at the same time, we still have positive tariffs levied on a lot of environmental goods, like wind turbines, for example. And the crazy thing is that today, policymakers are still arguing, are still discussing whether or not we should liberalize trade in environmental goods. There's negotiations going on right now, as we speak, to form a plurilateral agreement to liberalize trade in environmental goods. And it should be like a very easy agreement to negotiate, and it's not. Even that is hard. A second case would be something that has been very discussed in the press, which is local content requirements. Which is when you impose on someone the use of a locally made equipment or input. And there's been a lot of that in renewable energy. The most famous case was Ontario, where the province had a feed-in tariff, which said, if you want to get a feed-in tariff, you have to use Ontario-made equipment for renewable energy. That's obviously against all trade rules, right? WTO is really firm in that. You cannot do that. And so these cases of local content requirements have been challenged by different member countries in the WTO, and successfully so. So WTO said you have to remove these. Fine. I mean, as a trade economist, I can only agree. Problem is, there's also local content requirements for drilling equipment in countries like Brazil or Indonesia. No one cares. Never seen a single challenge on those. A third example would be subsidies. Like I mentioned subsidies already, but you've heard about countries like Germany, for example, where renewable energy subsidies are getting increasingly scrutinized. People are saying these are making our electricity bills way too high, they're inefficient, there's not much that much sun in Germany, so it doesn't make sense to subsidize solar there. At the same time, we still have fossil fuel subsidies that are above $500 billion a year. So again, why the different treatments? Why this blind spot? Last one I was going to take is export restrictions. Again, in WTO, we've got challenges for export restrictions on rare earths or some rare minerals, like in China. That's been a very disputed case. And the US won in WTO against China, who was restricting its exports of rare earths. When countries have export restrictions on fossil fuels, including the US until recently, again, no one challenges that, no one cares. The point is, there may be very good reasons why we treat those differently. You could say in the US, the export restrictions were not that binding until recently, whereas they are binding in China for rare earths. And there's many arguments that could be made. All I'm saying is, why the blind spots? Why look at those things with different eyes?
Interesting. Although it did take some time for the export restriction to be removed in the case of crude oil in the US. So WTO, trade negotiations. Do you have hope that those trade negotiations will address each of those four blind spots? Or do you see policymakers taking on these issues in new ways in forums like G20, elsewhere? I mean, clearly, producer subsidies have been brought to the fore. And we'll talk about that in a session this afternoon. What about those other double standards you raised? Content standards, you mentioned export restrictions.
Well, I'm trying to be optimistic here. I think there's already a legal and institutional architecture doing so. So the WTO for all its problems is still a functioning organization, and that's compared with all other institutions that has, the WTO has a dispute settlement mechanism, has legally binding provisions, which are lacking in the UNFCCC in other arenas. So I think we have the basic infrastructure for enforcing some kind of tougher discipline of fossil fuel restrictions or subsidies. The problem is the political will. We need countries that come to WTO with challenges. We need countries that come to WTO saying, let's get rid of that, because we've got the agreements, we've got the international treaties, and we've got the dispute settlement mechanisms. I know that some countries are already championing the issue in the WTO and in regional trade agreements. It hasn't been made very public because it's all happening behind the scenes and in corridors, but if you know the Trans-Pacific Partnership, so that's a big trade agreement between the US and a lot of other Pacific countries, including Japan and Australia and Mexico, etc. There was an earlier draft of the agreement that was leaked, I think, on the internet, and it had some provisions on the discipline of fossil fuel subsidies. They got removed in the final text of the agreement, but it shows that some countries thought, hey, let's include that in the agreement, in the trade agreement. In the WTO, you have countries like New Zealand that are actually pushing for some kind of plurilateral agreements on fossil fuel subsidies, just like there's already agreements on subsidies for agriculture and fisheries. So we need more political will, essentially.
Okay, political will, that's our job. So thank you so much, Jahan. We'll come back to, as mentioned, talking about subsidies shortly this afternoon. Why don't you join our panel and our last panelist. Thanks, Jahan. And our last panelist is Shivan Kartha, my colleague at Stockholm Environment Institute. And some of you may know Shivan as someone who's worked on this question of equity and fairness for some time. IPCC coordinating lead author for the fifth assessment report on this issue. And here we are on the supply side. And do we have to deal with equity on the supply side too?
We have to. That's a good question. Equity is a morass. Equity is extremely challenging in the climate realm, and no less so on the supply side. Paul gave us hope at the very beginning by saying, let's just let the market deal with it. Let's put constraints on demand, and then the wisdom of the market will translate that into preferences for certain supply, fossil supply assets, and not for others. That's the optimal strategy, that's the rational strategy, and Richard said, optimal, rational, what does that have to do with it? And I think that's kind of why we're all here. We realize that we need policies on all sides. And as soon as we start thinking about policies on the supply side, as soon as we start thinking about what will we constrain on the supply side, we have to take into account the fact that different suppliers want to extract their own supplies. And that has equity implications.
So how do you begin to address that? Maybe give us perhaps a little preview, but not a repeat, of what we're going to talk about the last session of this afternoon, equity and just transitions. What are some alternative frameworks for beginning to think about, you know, rights to produce?
Well, different people think about this very differently. You know, the student marching on a campus for divestment versus the social movement fighting for indigenous people's rights versus the investor in central London or Wall Street. There are different equity issues that come to the fore. And there are two, to try and really caricature it, to stylize it, there are two main different ways of thinking about this. One is that extraction is pollution, that it's the extractors who are fundamentally responsible. They're at the beginning of the supply chain, and their product ends up leading to pollution. And it's that kind of a perspective that has led to, you know, at the very least, calls for disclosure, so we could at least see what is the level of financial risk that these extractors, the firms or governments involved in it, are exposed to. But then even further than that, there really is also a sentiment among some that this isn't just pollution in some technical sense with financial implications, but this is pollution in the sense of there being a moral and ethical responsibility. This is pollution that ultimately ends up leading to the inundation of the small island states. So this needs to be dealt with as in the way that other ethical issues have been dealt with. And in many cases, people have started likening the issue of extraction to other ethical offenses as serious as apartheid or slavery. There are a few articles written on that. And then there's a whole other perspective, which is that it's not extraction is pollution. Extraction is development. We rely on this extraction. This extraction is what gives us livelihoods. This extraction leads to important levels of foreign exchange revenue. This extraction actually gives us some geopolitical power. It gives us some energy security. So these are almost diametrically opposed views. Is it pollution? Is it a bad? Or is it development? Is it a good? And it's somehow reconciling these two different, really different perspectives that we'll need to start thinking about if we start thinking about supply-side policies.
All right, listen, I think at this point, because we have a session on this very topic, I'm going to ask you to go over and sit and join our panel right now. And thanks again for introducing the topic. All right. I'll give you your card, too. And let me just say, since you've all been sitting here patiently on the panel, if you're dying to ask another panelist a question, you can do so before we circulate sort of panelist privilege. Anything that you want to corner one of your panel mates about? Yes?
What about historical responsibility for extraction?
That's a very good question. Historical responsibility has clearly been a very salient political issue in the climate negotiations. It's the issue of historical responsibility is actually, it's written in the Framework Convention itself as one of the fundamental underlying equity principles. And in on the supply side, it's in some ways just as salient, that there is a pretty radical disparity across the world in how much different countries have dug up and in the rents accruing to those countries due to that. Similar to on the demand side, historical responsibility on the supply side is of interest and is ethically salient in large part because we have this intuition that that historical responsibility, that those historical actions have actually led to some sort of profit, some sort of prosperity. It's contributed to development. So on both sides, I think it's helpful to think about the two together. Responsibility insofar as it is linked to a country's position in the world today, their level of capacity to deal with the problem, their level of capacity to support other countries who are straining to deal with the problem.
So Paul, you had a question.
Yeah, I'd like to continue the dialogue with Richard, really, given that I think you said something I proposed was mad. This is interesting, and it follows up on kind of on the coal thing, that have we given enough attention to coal? It's fascinating. I think what I heard you say was that there are some countries that are addressing their own domestic coal use, but that there's much less effort and in the case of Australia, no effort at all to address exports, and that, that therefore your idea of a moratorium would be to bring the exporters together in order to, effectively in order to stop that production or to reduce it. And I thought I heard you say that, that there was no way that that was going to happen, because why would countries do that? Which brings me back to the consumer side, because all those exports go somewhere and they end up in consuming countries. Consuming countries do have an economic incentive not to import because it costs them foreign exchange. And if the difference in cost between the coal and an alternative energy source, which may be an indigenous one, is not too great, and the countries therefore think that they are going to be spared the external costs of coal use, which are not insignificant, then I think consumer countries have a much better chance of curbing those exports than the exporting country. And just as with your example that the whaling moratorium was not brought about by the whaling nations, it was brought about by the non-whaling nations who didn't, they would have imported some stuff but from Wales, but they were prepared to forego that in order to get a moratorium and to drag the supply countries after them. And as we know, that moratorium is looking increasingly ragged because the producer countries are finding all sorts of ways to characterize it as scientific exploration, all that kind of stuff. So far from undermining my case that it's the consumer countries that are going to have to start it, whether we're talking about moratoria or whether we're talking about actually substituting for the imports, I think you strengthened it.
Spoken like a true economist. look, if we assume that the market will act rationally, and if we assume that powerful agents don't use their political power to prevent other people acting rationally, I agree with you 100%. But I don't think there's any evidence of markets, geopolitically significant markets, operating in that way. But big picture, the difference between what you're saying and what I'm saying is smaller than it might seem. I think it's great that some countries are going to buy less coal. Keep it up. Is that enough? You know, rest on your laurels and say, well, we're buying less. Gee, I hope all the Southeast Asian developing countries follow suit soon, or my country's stuffed. Great that you European countries are moving on from coal. Fantastic. Why not, while moving on from coal, place diplomatic pressure on countries like Australia? Why just have faith that the market will sort this out? My country subsidises the new mines that we're talking about. Like, we're pretty locked in to this course of development. And we, as I said, the low coal prices are our sales pitch to Bangladesh, to Cambodia. Rational agents would buy, I don't know how mobile phones are priced here in the UK, but in Australia you can pay a high price up front and have cheap calls, or you can pay a low price up front and have expensive calls. And I can get you a spreadsheet and pretty much convince you that you should probably pay the bit extra up front and get the cheap calls. But you know what poor people generally do? They pay the low price up front and high price going on. So in your model, does every country have the same discount rate? Does every country, rich and poor, have the same preference for contemporary consumption over future consumption? Because these assumptions are non-trivial. And when you add in that Japan and Australia will actually help finance the construction of your coal-fired power station, and no one's potentially offering you that for your renewable alternative, then maybe the market won't work as well as you'd like it to.
All right. So lest we have an ongoing debate, and it is Oxford, and I see many debate societies here around this very question of, will markets deliver? Let's turn to the audience here and see what questions pop up right away. So we've got France and Tina and the gentleman right here for round one, and then I see, just show me hands in general so I get an idea of where you are. Okay, thanks.
Thank you. My name is Tina Saltvedt from Nordea Bank in Norway. My first question is to Dr. Ekins. I could totally see your confusion by going to the oil and gas conferences in the north of Norway. Absolutely. You know, one of the arguments the oil companies in Norway is using is that they produce the cleanest oil because it's not, or they don't emit as much CO2. How do you think about that kind of argument? And my second question goes to Professor Carter. You talked about moral and ethical responsibility from the producing countries or producers, fossil fuel producers. But what about the financing of it? Should we also put some cost on the maybe banks or financial institution financing it? Thank you.
I'm Hugh Lee, I work in the coal industry. We're assuming that the fossil fuel companies at the moment are assuming that climate change policies are not going to work, and so they're going to continue to be able to sell their products. At what point, if climate change policies don't work, do we have a collapse in the world economy so there isn't a demand for their products? Is it too late?
And in the back we had.
So I don't know which of the panel, I'm Franz Matzner with NRDC from the United States, and not sure who to direct the question to, so I'm just gonna open it to the panel. I was intrigued by the continued sort of debate over as if supply side and demand side interactions are binary. And I'm wondering if the panelists could discuss like whether there's a way to look at these as being reinforcing so that you have, what I heard a lot is, you know, demand side policies are within the domestic context and they work mostly on the economic levers, and supply side is sort of not necessarily about economic optimization, but it's addressing the socio-political aspects of it. And if there's more research, so my question version of that is, what more research can we do to help bolster and reinforce with more evidence-based research the socio-political side and rationales for the interventions on the supply side?
Okay, thanks. Well, let me just ask our panelists for relatively brief replies and also keep our questions short because I saw a lot of hands go up.
I'll just touch on that last one. Look, I'm an economist. Economics is allegedly the science of the efficient allocation of scarce resources. Supply or demand aside, if, and again it's a big if, we were at all serious about tackling climate change, do we need more coal mines or less? Now, given that every quantitative analysis is less, then surely it can't be economically efficient to spend tens of billions of dollars building a new mine that no analysis says we need. So I agree, you don't have, any port in a storm, supply side policy, demand side policy, I think the binary says a lot about how economists think about problem solving rather than what is an effective suite of policies to move forward. But, you know, if you think economics is at all interested in the efficient allocation of scarce resources, the fact that we're today allocating scarce resources to build long-lived mines that we clearly don't need suggests that that's inefficient. Can we simultaneously have a price? Yeah, sure, why not? Could we use the price to fund, you know, paying people in developing countries to leave beautiful forests in place? Yeah, have a crack at that too. It's not rocket science.
So there are several questions here, so why don't just pass the microphone down and let everybody get a shot at it if they want to say something.
Let me address the Norwegian issue, because that was specifically directed to me. Yes, that was an argument that was certainly made very eloquently by the industry spokesperson, who was an extraordinarily impressive guy, very eloquent. He really knew his stuff. He made two arguments why Norway should be licensed in order to explore the Barents Sea. One is that it was clean oil, less CO2, and the other was that it was going to be cheap oil. The Barents Sea is not ice bound, so it's relatively shallow. So he was making the argument that actually the oil to come out of the Barents Sea will probably be cheaper than oil from elsewhere on the continental shelf of Norway, and therefore, you know, on my arguments, on my cost optimal arguments in the model, it should go ahead. And in fact, he was very critical of our modeling because we didn't go down to a project by project basis, because he said just saying Arctic oil is expensive, he says, is nonsense. There's lots of cheap Arctic oil up there, which is worth having. My argument to that was absolutely fine, Harald. You know, I can see the economic rationale. So who's not going to produce their oil in that's there to make, you know, to in order to give you that extra bit of carbon budget? And of course, his answer was the market will dictate. And so we come back to the points that Richard has made, which is there is currently no institutional framework to say, yeah, Norway can produce that, and somehow there will be compensation for the guys down the line who will not produce it. We know that in the current circumstances, if Norway produces more Arctic oil, that will be more oil and more carbon, just as the same as the coal thing is. And that's really what the debate revolved around.
Paul, anything you want to add to
just maybe on the question of demand side versus supply side approaches? I don't think here anyone on the panel would say that it's one or the other. I think most people would agree it's either demand side or demand side together with supply side. Problem is, when it comes to supply side, there's a whole variety of options that might be considered, like we saw this morning. But to me, the problem remains, what kind of commitment device, what kind of credibility and commitment device can countries put in place to ensure that they don't mine or drill? And so some of you were saying that the rents, the higher rents due to scarcity would be enough to consolidate the cartel, but I still have my doubts personally.
I want to leave time for the many hands that are up there. I think there was one question directed directly to you, Shivan, was that correct?
I would definitely agree that the finance sector has an important role to play. In any economy, especially in the capitalist economy, finance sector has a huge power in determining where our investment assets are allocated. And so the question is, do they see themselves as having an ethical responsibility, or do they see themselves as having only a fiduciary responsibility, and their sole objective being to maximize their profits? If it's the latter, then we have to rely entirely on issues like carbon asset risk disclosure and things like that to try and enhance the pressure on them for realizing this may not be a cost-effective response. But there are also roles for civil society in trying to emphasize the ethical role that the finance sector has as well, as they rather effectively did during the apartheid struggles, for example, or currently in issues like fair trade or slave labor or things like that. So I would say it's combination of the two, and civil society has a big role to play.
Thanks, Shivan. I guess it's our ethical role for short questions and short answers at this point in time. So hands I saw go up earlier, I saw Zebra, yes, is that correct? And then Iveta and Shell, and then we'll work down here.
Thank you. It's really close, so it's Zipporah. York University, Canada, and I'm also working to advise the Alberta government on a pathway to 2050 on oil sands. And I want to pick up on this comment you made, Dr. Ekins, around the idea that which assets are stranded will be decided by public policy in fossil fuel consumer countries and energy markets, because I think we have a time problem. There's no reason to believe that this will happen in time to keep us below 2 degrees. I think it's pretty clear that we need restrictions in supply side regions. And that's not going to come, certainly from the experience of Canada, with a high enough carbon price quick enough. So there are two ideas that I don't think you mentioned, Michael, when you kind of listed some of the ideas for supply side regions that I wanted to put on the table and hear what you're thinking about. One is the idea of the expansion of the kind of climate test or a global market economic analysis consistent with 1.5 degrees applied to both infrastructure and fossil fuel development within, for example, environmental assessment processes at a domestic level. And the second is your thoughts beyond high biodiversity areas in developing countries. And I was really excited by your proposal, María. But to constrain carbon within the UNFCC process and what kind of rules that would require. And I think if arguments can be made for permanence and additionality in forest offsets, not that I'm saying they're good arguments, but why aren't we looking at constrained carbon? Because if not, increasingly we have supply side regions like Canada committing to 1.5, but only really having an incentive to reduce production emissions to meet their INDCs.
A plea to keep your questions as short as possible, please.
Good morning. My name is Iveta Gerasimchuk, and I work with the Global Subsidies Initiative of ISD. I have a comment, which is very short, and the comment is that the line between a supply side and demand side is sometimes very fine, and this is also to respond to France. Because, for instance, in the electricity sector, if somebody is building a large coal plant, well, clearly, you can say it's on the demand side, but at the same time, it's locking in a market for supply and ultimately trickles out also on the supply side. So we find in our work it's sometimes very confusing with the electricity sector, how to classify that.
Good morning. I'm Kia Okuno with Leave It in the Ground Initiative, Lingo. I would like to thank Richard and Shivan for reminding us of the moral case. And when thinking about the challenge of keeping 80% or more of the fossil reserves in the ground, I believe there won't be one silver bullet. It has to come from different bits and pieces. And I think we already have a lot of things that we can work with. We have communities resisting pipelines getting built, and that has stranded tar sands in Canada. And just a comment on María Rosa's and Carlos' proposal, countries have committed in 2000 to legally prohibit extraction from protected areas. All the governments have signed that. And I think if we support local communities, if we support implementing that commitment, we might not have to pay governments on top of that to keep it in the ground in biodiverse areas.
Okay, thank you. So Paul, I heard a question for Paul and María, and then if anybody else wants to quickly add on to that.
Yeah, I think it to some extent is a false dichotomy between the supply and demand side, but I still think it will be the demanding nations that will lead initiatives at the global level. I mean, I think toughening up environmental impact assessments, trying to get these kinds of criteria into trade is all very important. I don't see enough happening on either the supply or the demand side to make me think that we're going to come anywhere near 2 degrees at the moment, and we clearly, to me, need all of that. I find the moral arguments obviously very important, but in other contexts, and we've heard about apartheid and slavery, the one I would draw attention to is the arms trade. The arms trade is, as not, there have been campaigns on the supply side, including in this country, which have not been particularly effective. I think for as long as there is no demand-side agreement that these weapons will not be purchased, then they will continue to be purchased. And I think the analogy with fossil fuels on the supply side is going to be very similar. Some of that will come at a national level. Some of that, I hope, will come eventually negotiated at a global level and will then affect the supply side. And that's where Richard and I think we join each other. But I still think the demand side and the demand side countries are the ones where the big action is going to have to take place.
It was fast to María, and then I know Frank, you wanted to make a quick comment too. María, I just want to get everybody.
Okay, I think one very important thing to understand when we talk about demand and supply side is that the way we account for emissions biases towards demand side policy. So if we are going to implement supply side policy, we have to develop a new way, not displace the old way, but have also an accounting way of accounting to emissions that favors supply side. So that would have to happen definitely. And in terms of additionality of the projects, if we had this accounting system, the projects that would have that would be financed would be projects that are economically viable. I mean, if we finance projects through the fund in places with, where there are fossil fuel reserves, not reserves, but resources that are not reserves, we are not creating additionality. So this is a very important point when we choose the deposits to be left in the ground. And something I must add, because of something Richard said, is that we're not paying to preserve biodiversity-rich areas. The funds would go to a low emissions development path, a whole transition, an economic transition in the country towards lower emissions and a different way of organizing the economy. So it's not just to preserve, because otherwise they would be the most expensive forests in the world. No, we're making development countries leaders in economic transition towards a low emissions economy. And about commitments to not exploit fossil fuels in biodiversity-rich areas. It doesn't seem that legal commitments are enough, because some countries commit, some companies commit, but definitely not all of them. And one process that does happen is that protected areas get delimited differently in order to allow for fossil fuel exploration. Sometimes they get delisted, they get changed in categories in order to allow for this. And sometimes even where it is prohibited, fossil fuel extraction goes on anyway.
All right, thanks, Maria. I'm going to have to be strict. I'm going to give it to Frank, gets the last. I know, Richard, I
Everyone's
know.
Everyone's ignored
Richard,
him better.
Richard, be equitable, Richard.
Be equitable.
Frank, you get the last word here.
Conference on supply side policy, okay? So demand side policy, as soon as you haven't got everyone on board, right? The ones who don't restrict demand will get their fossil fuels very, very cheaply unless there's supply side policy, right? That's important to keep in mind, I think, in terms of complementarity in a not perfect world, right? If it's a perfect world, you can have perfect supply only or demand only policy. But if there is anyone not in the tent, then you need supply side policy. And then just the moral case. I think the moral case for supply side policy is very strong, and it is very ineffective as well. And hence, you know, I see a lot of merit in attempts to identify policies that can deliver economic and distributional benefits to fossil fuel supplying countries.
All right, I want to thank the panel so much.